I am interviewing Wesley Matthews for the Veterans History Project of the Library of Congress American Folklife Center. We are in Studio X at Campbell Hall in Urbana, Illinois. Henry Radcliffe is the Director of Lighting, Sound, and Camera. Good morning. Good afternoon, Wes.
Oh, good afternoon,
Why don't you
Bill.
Start out by telling us where you were during the beginning of the war and how you came to be drafted?
Well, I was working for a local carpenter a little bit and working on the farm at home and a little day labor on farm for other farmers, you know.
Now, what year would this have been?
44 was okay. When I was drafted. But
prior to that, had you been in high school through the early part of the war?
I got out of high school in June 1940. I graduated early. And
then you were working, as you said?
I was just working around, day labor, you might say. Worked baling hay for guys, I mean, helping, you know, and anything on the farm.
Okay.
And working for this local carpenter. Later on, I married his daughter. He was dead by that time, but after I come back from the service.
So during the early years of the war, this is what you were doing, and then how did you come to enter the service?
Well, the draft caught up with me, you know, like did with everybody else. And on July the 28th of 1944, I was sworn in up at Fort Sheridan, Illinois, up at Great Lakes. It was quite an experience, you know. You had your exam there, and I don't remember now, 400, 800 guys maybe in the nude standing in this big, huge auditorium or whatever, and these women going by the big quadruple open doors laughing. I suppose it was quite a sight. We were sworn in, and then they read the Articles of War to us. And then they started compiling a service record. And I got some little civil service gal, and she had my name and birth date and my parents' name. And then she's going through pay, and she said, that will be $18.75 a month for a war bond. I've always been a rebel, I guess, and I said, I don't want one. And she told me everybody had to take one. Well, that immediately, you know, I really rebelled, and I said no. So she was astounded, and she called over a warrant officer, junior grade, and told him what I had done, and he shook his head and said, I can't handle this. And he called over a warrant officer, senior grade, and they both told him what I had done. And he shook his head more sadly and said, this is beyond me.
Now, what was your monthly total pay that they were taking?
I went in, they first started paying $50 a month.
So they were going to take out $18 out of that $50?
$18.75.
Oh, my goodness.
So they took all three of them, took me over to this major. But now I knew I'm in it, you know. And he was kind of a roly-poly, kindly father figure, you know. And they all took turns of telling him my sins. And he said, well, son, and when I call you son, you're really in trouble. He said, let me look at your service record. And like I said, it didn't have nothing on it yet. So he says, well, let's see. He said, you get $50 a month. And he said, the insurance will be six something or other. And then you'll probably have laundry taken out. He said, you'll wind up with better than $40 a month. And we have found, and it was the imperial we, you know, it's not good for one man in an outfit to have more, so much more money than the others. He said, most of those guys are married, got dependents, they wind up with, oh, maybe $17 a month. He said, what are you going to do with all this money? And I thought I'd be as good as he was, so I said, I guess I'll just invest it, sir. And he had a sense of humor, I'll give him that. He practically laid on the floor rolling and laughing, you know. And when he got up, he said, son, I believe you. and son, I'm going to help you. And he put me down for a $20 a month Class D allotment. I lost a dollar and a quarter a month on the deal.
Oh, no.
Yeah. So there I was, you know, and we get through there, and we get out to our barracks, and I think just about instantly I got assigned to KP the next day and all these kind of things, and fire guard of a night. I was at Camp Walters for 9 days, I believe, which was a real long period. And then they entrained a bunch of us, and we went to Camp Walters, Texas. And it's down in the panhandle of Texas. And there ain't nothing between you and Canada except a couple of barbed wire fences, you know. And when fall and winter came, that wind come blowing down there.
So this was for basic training?
That's for basic training. 8 weeks plus 11 weeks of extended training as a heavy weapons.
So you had been assigned to the infantry at that
time? I was in the infantry. Okay. This was an infantry replacement training center. And they tell you, don't worry about getting killed. You know, the casualty rate is only 2%, they told us. Well, 2%, that's 98 and 2, you know, and that's good odds, but it's your life you're betting. And I later discovered that in a hot infantry outfit in the ETO, the casualty rate was 3% per day.
Oh, my.
Yeah. Of operations, you know, combat. And that did make a difference.
Of course.
But that was my start down there, you know. I had this 11 weeks of extended training. And December the 16th is a day of great importance in the U.S. history. The Boston Tea Party, my birthday, the Battle of the Bulge started. My 21st birthday, they called me over to the orderly room and said, there's a boat in Boston Harbor, get on it.
You were in Texas at the time?
I was in Texas. And I had a 10-day delay en route, so I did get to spend Christmas time at home. Went to Fort Meade, Maryland. And when I got changed trains in Chicago, and I ran into a bunch of guys that I went through training with, including one named Roger, who I'll tell you a lot about later.
Okay.
And Roger told me one time later, said, it's probably a good thing they split us up. We might even have lost the war if they hadn't.
Kept you together.
Put together. And we did cause a commotion a time or two. And I remember once going through training there, and we come marching in back to the company area at lunchtime, and we were doing these cadences, you know, counting them, and this was one on every fourth step, and then every second step, and then every step, and you wound up, and we went A and R, M, Y, you know, wound up, you shouted Army. And as I said, I was always a rebel, and I think maybe I was an agitator, because we went by the orderly room, I'd get them all together, and we shouted Navy.
Oh,
that was not a good idea.
You hadn't learned a lesson yet.
Hadn't learned yet. But anyway, this is where we trained.
Is it possible to sort of reconstruct what was going through the minds of you and your recruits? Because you knew what was, that you were in, probably going to a very hot theater of operations. And
well, actually, we were trained for the Pacific, we thought.
Oh.
Jungle training.
Oh, my gosh.
And then they sent us into Belgium and Germany in the heart of the winter, you know.
Yep.
Went up in the Ardennes Mountains. They told me the first day it was 15 below zero. The wind was blowing about 40 miles an hour, and there in the mountains, the snow was packed in 4 to 5 foot deep. And three-fourths of the battalion was living in foxholes.
Oh, my goodness.
And the thought was, but they told you that if you got frozen feet or trench foot, you'd be court-martialed. All you had to do was take your shoes and socks off and massage your feet every little bit, and you wouldn't get trench foot.
Mm-hmm.
You tell me how that you take your shoes off when it's 15 below.
In a foxhole.
Yeah, in a foxhole. And where are you going to get the dry socks to put on?
Well, made you skip a step. Let's go back. You were in Maryland on your way there. So then you did get to Boston eventually?
Well, they sent us up to Camp Miles Standish in Massachusetts on the 31st day of December, New Year's Eve. We got in there, and we was on a 20-minute alert. They said we couldn't take off our shoes or nothing, but they let us off the train. And we went in, we was allowed to sit down on the bunks, and finally they told us we could lay down. And then later on they said, well, you can take off your boots.
That was nice.
But we was there all night, and they fed us breakfast, and we got back on the train and headed for Boston. I learned later, figured it out, but what they done, as the ship's loaded, it's not an exact science, you know. And they kept these trains running around out there, and when I got about ready for one, well, they ordered them to come on in. And we go through the outskirts of Boston, all these tenement houses about 4 and 5 stories high. Mm-hmm. And they had MPs at all doors on the cars, you know, in case somebody got reluctant to get out of the States. And we, all of a sudden, it was a full emergency stop, some little kids out on the tracks. And several cars passed over him, but he's in the middle of the tracks and wasn't hurt. But we was held up there while they found his mother, and the cops come and took them all away, you know. And we finally pulled in between these two big buildings. Well, there's a wall on each side. They opened the door and let us out on one side, and opened the door here, and we go in. And they opened the door on the other side, and there's the gangplank.
Oh, my gosh.
And we was aboard the Thomas H. Berry. That was an old Army troop transport. And we left on New Year's Day, 1945, out across the North Atlantic. We were the largest ship in the convoy. The North Atlantic's always stormy in the wintertime, you know. And we had waves breaking over A deck on our ship before they chased us all below.
Oh my gosh.
And of course, most of the guys were seasick.
Were you in bunks or?
They have these pipe bunks made and with canvas on them, like a hammock. Mm-hmm. And you have 18 inches between them.
Between you and the person whose bunk is right above yours?
I think they were 6 or 7 high.
Oh my gosh.
And we were just below the water line, so I knew what was going to happen if we got torpedoed, you know. But, and you had your rifle and everything there. No, we didn't have a rifle. We had a barracks bag there. Right. Some of them went with rifles. I didn't have one. And you couldn't double up your knees, of course. And only the top guy had a light so he could ride of night or anything, you know. This was 15 days across the North Atlantic.
15 days?
We're zigzagging in a big convoy. Okay. We got to Le Havre, France, and they had finally got a passageway opened up. We got in to a pier, but on both sides you could see sunken ships, you know, and the tops of them, just debris all over, but they had cleared passageways. When we debarked, and we had to carry everything and walk to the top of the hill about 4 miles, there was a railroad track down there, but that train, the engine couldn't pull all of us uphill.
Oh.
Little old narrow gauge. There was 40-some cars in our train. They were fastened together with clevises and a chain, you know. The engine had brakes. And when he stopped, it was just thump, 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 you know. And I was about the 39th or 40th car, and so I had a long time to prepare to get knocked down. And when he took off, it was just a reverse, you know, jerk, 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 jerk. And he had a speed time he got to us.
So you really were jerked.
We were really jerked. And it was 148 miles, somebody told me, from Le Havre to Givet, France, which was right on the Belgian border. And it took us that night and the next day and night and the next day and more than half of the next night. And we'd really get be rattling down the line, and you'd think, boy, we're going now, and you'd open the door. Here'd be some kid walking along passing you.
I mean, were they going slowly just because it was so heavy? Or?
Well, I don't think so, just about what it could do.
Oh, I see.
And we stopped at, I think it was Leon, and they had a change of engineer and fireman.
Right.
The new one come on duty, and they each one of them had a satchel like a kid would carry books in, and had two loaves of French bread and a couple of bottles of wine in there. We made a deal and traded them out of their bread and goat milk, cheese, and wine.
Well, were you being fed during that long railroad trip? Or
they fed us C rations, yeah, or K rations, and there was no heat, and it was colder than hell. And I remember trying to heat a cup of coffee in my canteen cup with a cigarette lighter.
Oh.
It don't work.
Yes.
But they had water, you know, and we had canteens of water. And we got to Givet, and as I said, in the middle of the night. And always the first thing they do, they give you a meal. When you change stations, you know, from...
Right.
Well, they took us in. They had these tents, the cook tent, and the sides were rolled up on all of them. And it's cold, as I said, and these tent ropes out there in the dark, can't have a light. We got a cold pork chop and a cold boiled potato about that big around, and cold gravy and cold coffee.
Oh, welcome to Givet, yes.
Welcome to Givet. We were there, I think, 2 days. And they quartered us in an old factory building, and it had been added on to successively, and shed roof, and each time it got lower, you know. And I was at the back end, and I had to go permanently like this back there, about a 40-watt bulb to light your way. And the first day we got out, when they said they was done orienting us on what we had to do, and talked to some Belgian kid, and I give him, I think, 4 cigarettes out of a K-ration pack, and he took my helmet, just the tin pot, home, filled it up full of hot water and brought it back, and I shaved.
Clever.
Yeah, and he pretty soon had a thriving business. He was running home. We left there, they put us on trucks, and we headed out across Belgium, and I can't remember what all towns we went through, but it got colder and colder as we got nearer into the Ardennes. We laid over one night, I think, and they had cots with a blanket on them, and when we left the next morning, why, filched the blanket off of my cot and took it with me. I thought I might need it. It's getting awful cold. And we went to, by truck, to Gehalde, Herberg, Belgium, which was right on the German border. And pre-World War I had been German territory, I guess. And this people spoke German, Deutsch, you know. And then they put us, Roger and I got on in the back end of a Jeep. We got hauled up through Monschau and down to a town called Hoffen. Well, I never heard anything except Hoffen until years later, when I got some books about the battalion. And actually, we was in a little hamlet, a dorf down on the end of probably 8 or 10 houses at the most, a place called Alzen. And I joined up with the 3rd Battalion, of the 395th Infantry Regiment, the 99th Infantry Division. And I was in L Company and went to a mortar section. That was the light 60s. And the infantry company has a machine gun section and a mortar section. And the 4th Company in each battalion is heavy weapons. They have the water-cooled machine guns and the 81-millimeter mortars. The only difference between the 81-millimeter and the 60-millimeter is size. Mm-hmm. You understand, they operate exactly the same way.
They're both easily portable, or somewhat portable? Or?
The 81, you broke it down into three parts. It's big. The 60 was all in one. It folded up and you had a strap to carry it. And it was a man killer.
I bet.
But I was an ammo bearer, and I had about 45 pounds of ammunition and my own equipment. You had this pack, had 6 rounds in front and 6 rounds behind.
Wow.
And it went over your neck and on your shoulders. Most time I carried it on one shoulder or the other so that I could pitch it if I had to hit the ground. I didn't want that much between me and the dirt. You know, I wanted as low as I could get.
So you have arrived as replacement soldiers?
Yes.
For this group, this infantry unit.
Yes, that company. And Roger and I both got in the same platoon, but I went to the mortars, and he went in as, I think, a section runner for the mortar section.
Now, when you arrived, what sort of training would they give you about being actually in the war as opposed to being in Texas and being trained for the war?
The guys talked to me and they told me, they said, we don't know how patriotic you were, whether on December the 8th you was down there at the recruiting office before it opened on Monday morning trying to sign up, or the draft board drug you out from beneath the bed. But we will tell you right now, after the first 5 minutes, you'll be fighting to save your own rear. And that was the training I got.
That was it?
That was it. And they gave me a old rusty carbine. It had one magazine, and there was 7 rounds in it. The magazine holds 15. And everybody was going around carrying at least 4 or 5 magazines. And I begged a round apiece from enough guys to fill up the magazine I had. Cleaned the gun up, and they said, don't shoot it, you might draw fire. Now, here I am carrying a weapon that I don't know will fire, you know.
You had no time to test it out?
They wouldn't let me.
Oh, my.
Don't shoot it.
Oh.
And about a week later, we reorganized. Somebody had got hit in one of the squads. And they, when I went in, I was carrying a pair of combat boots and wearing arctics and combat boots. And the company was all wearing shoes and leggings out there in that snow. And I looked around at them, and I couldn't just hold a pair of combat boots. So I said, who wears 10.5D? Just give me something to turn in. So a guy named Stuart Roper got my combat boots, and he got moved up and went from a carbine to a 45 pistol in his new job. And so I traded carbines with him. I said, how's it shoot? And he said, I hit Zeller 3 for 3 in the dark. Zeller was the squad sergeant. And Zeller had went out checking the outposts. Well, they had a sound phone to every outpost. And you called ahead and told them he was coming, you know.
You should, yeah.
And he didn't call and tell them when he went to go back, and he went the wrong way. And he walked up on old Stu in the dark and got shot for his pains.
Fatally?
No, he lived
good
through it, but he had both hips broke.
Oh, no.
He was in bad shape.
I can see why.
But I had a carbine that they assured me would shoot, you know, and had 2 new magazines. And later on, I picked up more, and I even picked up a cloth machine gun belt and put it on the outside of my pistol belt. You carried all your equipment on your pistol belt, even though you didn't have a pistol, or I didn't see. Mm. Your canteen and everything went on that belt. And I attached that on there, and I had about 50 rounds around my waist, and I think I finally had maybe 7 magazines. I was prepared for a war, you know.
Were you able to walk?
Well, yes. And as I said, it was cold, and I was wearing all the clothing I had. Two sets of long johns, two wool uniforms, a pair of gas pants, a wool sweater, and a field jacket, and a wool scarf, and they had those wool back gloves with split leather palm. And they didn't protect your hands and didn't keep them from freezing. I had both feet frostbit. And it was not a happy situation, let me clue you right there.
And was this pretty typical of your fellow infantrymen?
Yeah. Yeah. They had been there.
The frostbite and things like that.
Yeah. Later on, I turned in the battalion surgeon, and he told me over 100 men in the battalion had frostbite at least as bad as I did. And he's supposed to send us back, but there wasn't no replacement, so he said, guess what? And he gave me 6 pills, what they called APC, and I think it's the equivalent of an Anacin. And I talked to the company medic, and old Pack told me, he said, at this stage, you'd be easy to cure. Just complete bed rest and elevate your feet.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Well, 2 weeks after he told me that, I had complete bed rest and my feet elevated. I was in a hospital in England after
we're
he told me that.
We're going to come to that in a minute, I'm sure, yeah. Yes, as to how you got there.
Yeah, but anyway, we was there just a week, and I got in the last part of the Battle of the Bulge. So I got a battle star for it, although I really didn't do anything in the important part of it. But I did get to range up and down the line of mopping up and straightening out the line and so on, down to not too far above Luxembourg.
So you were in the situation where the Germans and the American troops were facing each other across this
yeah, anywhere
this
from 200 to
line.
600 yards.
Oh, my. And you were dug in on the American side as well?
We were dug in, and we were had several pillboxes in the Siegfried line that we held. And, of course, see, they faced the wrong way.
That's true.
But we had one of them stacked clear full of mortar ammunition. And we were supposed to be sending out patrols every night while we was there in Hoffen. And I talked to some of the guys later. I was always curious about where I was and which direction I needed to run if I had to run, you know. And some of the privates told me, said, we're really not going too far into the German lines. We go down to the foot of the hill and we sit down for about 2 hours and we come back.
Oh, well, this was a patrol.
Yeah.
I see.
Well, another regiment attacked it through our battalion area. And I think it was the 31st of January, because we left there on February the 1. And they went out there and they ran into all of those German dugouts that the officer that was leading the patrols was telling them wasn't nothing out there. So all they could do, they grabbed their stuff and ran right on through them, see? And the next day they sent us out to clean them out.
Ooh.
Now we got a 60-millimeter mortar. It's great for anti-personnel. You catch them in the open, knocking out bunkers, it's useless, you know.
Oh.
All we did, we went out and got some people hurt, but we stayed out all day. We went back to Cahal de Herberg when they pulled us out of there, and the Germans were shelling the road. So we cut across country, and the hill was so steep, the engineers had cleaned the pine trees off an area, and they was winching trucks up, and we were going down beside the road, and you'd aim at a fir tree down there, slide down and catch, and then aim for another, you know, and go on down that way, and walked out of there. We got back to Cahal de Herberg, and I think I got first tour guard duty. It was dark when we got there. I got my 2 hours over with and went into this house that we'd picked, you know, and it had a roof on it, not much else. And artillery had tore it up pretty bad. And there was a bunch of 240s, 240-millimeter cannon drawn up out there.
Okay.
I just got my bedroll rolled out and laid down, and they fired, and all the plaster fell off the ceiling right in my face.
These were real artillery pieces, I take it.
Yeah, they were real. Yeah, right. That's the biggest we had in the Army, okay. 240.
Wow.
And so I set up a cussing, and I got all of the plaster dirt out of my eyes where they made us fall out. And we're going to go out and clean out those bunkers, you know. We stood there till daylight, and then they fed us breakfast, and then we stood a while longer, and then we moved out. We were stretched out in a single file, battalion long, and I was pretty much to the end of the line, just the way it stood, you know. And two mortar rounds come in, the Germans had fired, and one hit off to my right front a little bit, and the other one seemed to be just right slightly behind me. But when the first one hit, a second or two ahead of the second one, I was in a dive for the ground. And the second one, it felt like something hit me over the kidney. I kept feeling all day trying to find blood, but there wasn't none. It was just shock, you know. But the second and third man in front of me got hit, and the second guy behind me. And I crawled up to the first guy. He's laying there, his hands up above his head, kind of, you know, face down, turned sideways, his head, and just mumbling cusses, you know. And I'm saying, QE, what's wrong? Where you hit, you know? And, come on, you so-and-so, where you hit? And I finally figured it out. He had a little shrapnel wound right here on the inside of his thigh, just a flake. Oh. And he had one on the other side that hadn't healed up yet. He'd got a week or two before.
Oh, my goodness.
And he was saying, the Germans trying to make sure there'd never be any little Wilsons running around.
I can see his anger.
Well, so I crawled up to the next guy, and there wasn't no doubt where he was hit. The blood was bubbling out the middle of his back, and I split open all of his clothes, you know, and, well, it's dark blood. It's not bright red, and it's bubbling out, but it's not shooting out. And pretty soon here come a medic, and we got a pad on him, and the litter bearers come by carrying out somebody up the front of the line that got hit, and old Link said, I think I could walk out with him, and he did. He got back, and when they got time to work on him with a surgeon told him, said, you're the luckiest SOB alive. That piece of shrapnel had took out about a teaspoonful of flesh, about so close to the backbone and right between two ribs.
Wow.
Never damaged any bone or anything,
well,
see.
Didn't leave him paraplegic, yeah.
So they gave him limited duty. He got to carry rations up to us for a week. Mm-hmm. He could still get killed, you know, but he's on limited duty.
Right.
As I said, we ranged all up and down there, mopping up.
Had you actually been hit or just?
No, it was just a concussion that hit me.
Okay.
But the next day I discovered I had shrapnel holes through all my clothes above and below my arm. Now, that don't mean they both went at the same time, but probably did.
My gosh.
And old Roper, he had one across that had just about cut the pocket out of his pants. Didn't know it till the next day. We was busy that day. You know, you don't even have time to look yourself over, really, you know.
Right. If there are no mirrors or anything.
No mirrors or anything. And besides, it was 15 below zero, you know. It would have fogged over. I don't remember where we went that night, but we wandered around out there and was in foxholes that we dug. Well, you get down the ground, that'll dig through the snow. And spent the nights out, you know, and we finally went back to somewhere up around Wames, Belgium, or somewhere or other, or just off of the Elsenborn Ridge. And during the Battle of the Bulge, the two sister regiments fought their way back to there, and when they got there, well, then they had a field of fire and they could hold the Germans. And the battalion I was in was the only unit of the First Army that wasn't pushed out of position during the Battle of the Bulge. And the whole thing was due to the fact that they had a field of fire in front of them, see? And on their left flank, the last unit of the First Army The 12th Army was on our left. There was a, I don't know what they called them, anti-tank or what, but they had 37 millimeter cannon, and they had a lot of rounds with grape shot in them, mm-hmm. and a personnel.
Canister type things, yeah.
And that was deadly. The Germans was coming at them, you know, just waves of them, and the same way down there with the battalion that I later joined. And it's impossible, you say, that enough guys here, you know, and they're charging. But they got pushed off the top of the hill twice, they told me, and retook it both times.
Wow.
So they was attacked by about three regiments of Germans.
So this was the peak penetration on that sector of the German...
Our battalion area. To our right, they went back 40-some miles.
Whoa.
Got clear back to just opposite Jebe. They got to the Meuse River. But anyway, I got to work for the engineers there while we was at this first little rest we had. And we went down to a Bulge, Belgium, a town of maybe 100 houses, I don't know. It'd been a big tank battle there, and we lost a lot, and the Germans did too. And the houses all burned out, old stone houses. They backed trucks up to the walls. We levered those stone walls down in the trucks and hauled them out there where they was building a roadbed, rolled them out and sledged them up into little rocks to make a solid base.
Oh, my gosh.
And the engineers told us they was damn sorry, but they couldn't get full rations for us. We're doing it on half rations. And anyway, I got, like I said, half rations there working for them, pounding rock. They'd truck us back to the battalion of a night. And the battalion, when we got there, they, I don't know if the cooks left soap in the dishes or what, or the pans, but everybody had diarrhea.
Oh.
And I was one of the few guys that wasn't down, so I got to dig straddle trenches, stand double tour guard duty, and then work for the engineers during the day.
I think you preferred combat.
Yeah. And I think I can tell this story. Roger, we'd dig these straddle trenches back away from them. This is a one-street town, you understand me? A little hamlet.
Yep.
Dig these straddle trenches back away from the road a little ways, and he discovered an open shed down there, and the wind didn't blow up his back quite as bad. So he has to make the run, and he goes down there. And a funeral procession went by. Horse-drawn hearse, and the mourners are all walking. And they all spoke to him, said, "Gutop."
While he's taking care of business?
While he's taking care of business.
Oh, no. Having the runs, oh gosh. Take some poise.
So that was the highlight of his career, maybe, I don't know. Anyhow, we left there and we got to go out and do a little more again of straightening up and mopping up. And on Valentine's Day, I said, and I read the history books and I read everything from the 11th, 12th, or 13th. We were relieved by another division. But I said it was Valentine's Day. I still think it was where my company got relieved. And we
so
walked.
You've been there for over a month now, or a month and a half.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Since almost January 1st.
Right? Anyway, they put us on trucks after we walked out of ways, and we went back somewhere in the woods, and they dumped the company packs and bedrolls out in a pile, like company piles. No lights. And one of these fir forests, you know, darker than hell anyway. And the only other guy in the company that had a shoulder half that matched mine was Roger.
Oh.
And I found him in all that darkness, and I said, "Let's put up a tent." And he said, "Gee," said, "I'm supposed to bunk in with Sergeant Jake. They wanted us right there by the company CP."
He's still a runner? this time? Or
he's what?
He's still being a runner at this time?
So. He's still a runner.
Right.
So I finally talked four guys. We put up a four-man tent with their shelter halves. We rolled out my bedroll, and the snow was going off with a big rain and the snow. And those big trees would hold maybe 15, 20 bushels of snow, and then they'd turn upside down and dump it. And I suppose more than half the guys just stood up to a tree and locked their arms around it, you know. Didn't hit, get hit so bad by this stuff coming down. About daylight, it really cut loose and was a storming, and three more guys dived in that tent with us. It was already five in a four-man tent. We were stacked up just like a pyramid, you know. But we left there, and we went to back up into Belgium somewhere other and stayed overnight, I think. And then we headed for a five-day real rest. And they didn't have trucks enough, so they'd truck you ways, you'd walk aways, they'd pick up the rest of them. And I walked past that potato patch where the Germans mowed down those 70-some guys, you know, after they'd surrendered.
Oh, my.
Through Malmondy. And we finally wound up at a place called La Minerie, Themister Province, I guess, Belgium. And it was, I'll call it a triangle. And they built around the outside, and the middle was the common, the green, a pasture,
mm-hmm.
and houses down two sides, and some businesses on the third side. There was a bakery down there and quite a few other things. And we were quartered in houses. The Belgians took us in. And the room I was in was heated by a cook stove.
Mm.
And the first night, why the other three guys that was in there, they went downtown looking for booze and broads, you know. And I did a little calculating. I thought a town of this size, there's probably two eligible women. Here's 400 guys. I went down to the bakery, and I discovered that every place that did business also sold booze, you know.
Oh.
So if I remember rightly, I bought a liter of cognac and three of wine and a dozen little apple tarts or pies.
Oh.
Went back, and Roger joined me, and we ate the pies. Drank two bottles of wine and the cognac. We was going to save one bottle of wine to sober up on. Forget it. We finally drank that too. The last thing I remembered, he was standing up on a chair and holding on to a door, and it was swinging. And he was having a horrible job hanging on. And the condition he was in, and the door swinging and all, and he was reciting Dangerous Dan McGrew. Not the authorized version, you understand? You probably know the other. And we were there 5 days. They took my combat boots away from me that first week up there and gave me some snow packs. But they didn't have the inserts for them, that shoe, felt shoe with a sole. They said, just put on socks. Well, I had two or three pairs of socks, and that's all I had. And your feet just flopped around in them, and I just rubbed and made it worse, you know. And they weren't waterproof because they were leather above that little bottom shoe, you know. Well, they gave us back combat boots, and we had a training program. Had to go out, us guys that weren't in the company, had fired for record in the company, we had to go out and fire the mortar.
Now you did that?
Yeah, I did that.
After being in the front lines?
Yeah, oh yeah. And we had to play a little volleyball and all that to keep in shape. And we was changed corps, went from one Army Corps to another. And the two generals come down, one to see us off and the other to welcome us, you know. They drawed us up out in this village green. And it was raining, so the two generals and their entourage are standing back there under a porch waiting for it to quit raining, and we're out there in the rain. And I was pretty well to the back as the battalion formation stood anyway, and pretty soon I noticed that the ranks was getting awful thin. So I kept watching out of the corner of my eye, and pretty soon I seen a guy go back and This was a hedge about waist high around there, and he laid down on that and rolled over and went crawling off. So pretty soon I was back there and gone too, and I went down to the bakery, and when it quit raining and the generals come out, there was a handful of non-coms left. Instead of a battalion of 300 or 400 men, you know. Yes. So they rounded us all up, and by that time we were drinking beer and eating gingerbread. That was the bake of the day at the bakery.
Okay.
That's a good combination, but you can make do with what you have to do, you know. The general gave us a little talk, and he said, "Man," he said, "here too far," he said, "we've been in the hole, and the Germans been coming at us." And he said, "Now, he's going to be in the hole, and we're going to be routing him out, and that's what we want." And I didn't hear a bit of applause, you know. But anyway, they trucked us out of there then, and when we went to leave that morning, they didn't tell us ahead of time, but they fed us breakfast and then told us we had 20 minutes to get everything packed. So I ran down to the bakery where I was buying my wet goods, and I bought 3 bottles of cognac, I remember. Ooh. And I tucked one inside my field jacket, and I give Roger one. He rolled it in his bedroll, and I rolled one in mine. And we turned them in with the company bedrolls, and the company trucked them. You don't want a truck. And we went up through Stolberg, Belgium, and they quartered us that night in a big mansion, I guess you'd call it, a 4-story house on Millionaire's Row. The 4th floor was a ballroom. Mm. And that was the first big chandelier I ever saw that you could push up to the ceiling. You know, it had that spring in it and bring it down. The ceiling was probably 14, 15 foot high. And Roger and I was up there playing and sending her up and down. And we give it too much of a pull, I guess, and that thing come down and all that crystal shattered.
Oh, my.
Yeah, we ran, as usual. But the next day they had us all on trucks, and I noticed a light kept flashing on us, you know. So I borrowed the sergeant's field glasses, and finally discovered the source of light, and there was 2 gals up in a observation tower on top of one of them houses. They had some opera glasses watching us, so we waved them down and talked to them, and they brought down an old wind-up Victrola and was playing their latest hit music from the States.
Wow.
Pirated from Germany. Huh. So anyhow, while you along comes some officer, and you know how they can always run the party. It was, they told us $65, you know, for fraternizing. And we were in German territory.
Oh.
And they never did collect the money, but they told us they was going to. And we crossed the river, they just made a crossing on the Ruhr. Crossed the river at, I don't know, it was Lenich on the one side, I think, and Durin on the other. And they'd had to take dozers and clear up roads through Durin. You'd see brick walls standing maybe 20 foot long and side of a building 10, 15 foot high, you know. And there was a statue of old Bismarck in town there, and he had been facing France. And the artillery had turned him around the base, and he's facing back in Germany. But anyway, they took us through there, and I don't remember how far out, but they kicked us out. And I remember we were running down this little narrow oiled road, and there was a firefight going on ahead of us, a rifleman up there. And I was running beside one of the light machine gunners, and he had 30 or 40 rounds hanging on a cloth belt. He'd cut the rest of it off, see? And he had a sling on it, and he could fire it like a BAR fart from the hip.
Mm.
Didn't have to put the tripod or the bipod down. We're running down this road, and he was kind of a dark-skinned Italiano descendant. And I look at him, and he's turning awful white. And he's starting to fold up, and I thought, that's good enough for me. And I went to my knees, and I looked, and on my left was a header. There was a box culvert under the road there. And there was a German machine gunner, had that Schmeisser up on the end of that header. And I went inside of that thing, skating on my knees, and pushed it up. And I think he wanted to surrender, because we were screaming at him, you know. I was afraid to pull the trigger. I had my carbine right on his chest. I was afraid to pull the trigger. Death throws, he'd pull that trigger on that thing and get a bunch of guys, you know. Right. So he just let it kind of slide out of his hand, and it went back down the ditch. And we grabbed him by the shoulders and drug him up over there and headed him in the right direction and kicked him in the rear. Told him to get out of here, you know. And he went off trotting down the road real happy, throwed his helmet off. And probably the next guy'd come along, shot him, but we didn't.
Okay.
We get on up there without any further problems and hang around till dark and move up a little further. And we're attacking Bergheim on the Erft Canal.
Now, are you joining troops already in battle, or are you the first ones there?
Well, they'd had a firefight, but it cleaned up, and we were back in a battalion group, you know, whatever, strung out there. And we went up, they had the artillery drawn up in big arcs, and furthest back was the 240s. And then in front of them was the 155s, that was the 6-inchers. And then the 105s was in front of them. And the 240s were, well, 220 yards or more apart, you know, and had camouflage nets over. The 155s were half that distance apart in a big arc. And then the 105s, they had their camouflage nets, stakes were in between. They both tied on the same set of stakes, you know, one each way. So we'd go up underneath all of that and wait. And we were attached to the 7th Armored, I believe. We had tanks with us, and this was their objective. We were attached to them. And the I Company and K Company were attacking with the tanks, and L Company that I was in. We was going to go around and get in there about 4 o'clock in the morning, and they jumped off at midnight. We was going to get there about 4 o'clock in the morning, give them any help they needed mopping up. Well, my personal opinion is we got lost, and I thought we'd come in from the backside of the German lines, and it was like a street brawl. They hadn't cleaned it out or anything. They'd been pinned down since midnight. They said they went out about 200 yards and got pinned down by German artillery and couldn't move. And we crossed a creek, and was somebody had direct observation on us, and they chased us around with artillery, and they'd fire, and you'd wait till it hit, and then you'd get up and run someplace else, you know. And we wound up at the foot of this bluff, and there was a cemetery there, and I dived into one open grave on one of my tours around the cemetery. And finally we got the Air Force. That's the only time I ever knew they'd come on time when we hollered. And three P-51s showed up, and they bombed and strafed the top of this bluff. And it was just about straight up, but there was trees and stuff you could hang on to and climb it. And on their third pass or whatever, why we was going over the top, we run down along the railroad embankment. It's an old walled-in town on that end. And there was Germans that dug into the high ground on this embankment there. It was kind of swampy off on our right the way we were going. And we come down there to a dugout, and two German soldiers come out. The first one was a private, and the second one was a corporal, whatever they called them. And the BAR gunner sent his ammo bearer down to check. There's nobody down there in that dugout in the dark, you know. And he hit a tripwire and a booby trap.
Ooh.
Yeah. And this corporal laughed. Well, it was probably a nervous reaction, but he laughed. And the BAR man come spinning around, you know, and he'd been holding it down the steps there, and he was bringing it up, and the company exec officer knocked it up and said, not now. I want the rest of them to surrender. Mm. We wound up with 6 prisoners pretty soon. Got to the end of the wall and told the BAR man to take them back to battalion. Well, I didn't know they'd be able to move yet, you know. I thought they was 4 miles back. The guy went around the corner of the wall and come back in a minute or so, you know, and I heard that BAR go off all 20 rounds. And the company exec said, deliver them back to battalion. He come back and said, they're delivered. And I didn't go around to look or nothing. But I knew how he delivered them. So there was atrocities both sides, if you could call it that, you know. But I figure when a guy surrenders and then sets a booby trap that he deserves to die, and that corporal had done that, you know. Anyway, well, we take this town, and this is the end of it, and pretty soon we was running down some old crooked cobblestone streets, and the assistant gunner had my mortar, and I don't know where the other ammo bearer was or the gunner was, and I think we had 2 riflemen with us, and one of them might have been a BAR man, but we're running down these streets, and we'd go around the corner, and 2 or 3 German riflemen would pop out of the doorways, and they must have already fired at us, because in my memory, every one of them was giving an old bolt this, you know, to give us another round. And this assistant gunner, he'd dive for the cobblestones and jerk that bipod out, and I'd drop 2 rounds in, jerk all the increments off. So all they did just pop out and come down in front of us, you know, and get bury your nose in the cobblestones, and it went over all the time. The rifleman or BR man or whatever it was shooting. We'd get up and go around another corner and do it again. We did that about 3 or 4 times. When we came back down the street, I hit every store that was along there and hit the cash register. It was German money, you know. And I thought I was doing pretty good, but that night they took the company out. We went out to fill up a gap or something or other. I knew what happened to a German soldier if you caught him with GI boots on or something, you know. He was dead, and I didn't want to get caught with German money, so I burnt all of it but 1 or 2 pieces. When I got back to England, it was good as gold. Oh. Turn it in. Oh. I'd burned an awful lot of money. But anyway, why? We go back into town for that night after they took us out there. But while we was in town, somebody discovered a winery. So he was all going around carrying a case of wine. Wasn't drinking much of it or anything. And I discovered I don't know what this guy was, instructor, professor or something. And I had on an opera hat, you know, one of these folding hats. And I had it opened out and on sitting on my helmet. Had on a Nazi armband and a sword hanging on my side, and was going down the street with a couple more guys who was cleaning out the town. And all of us carrying a case of wine, which we ditched pretty soon. I company discovered a bank in town. And rumor was that they looked through a window or door or something or other, got a bazooka aimed just right for the vault, and then ducked back and squeezed the trigger. Paper money floated all over that town. They'd robbed that bank. I guess you could call it robbing, or liberated, whatever they wanted to call it. And
we need to change tapes. We're going to take a pause. So you're in the town. The bank has just been robbed.
Liberated. I like to prefer that word.
So the town is secure. There are no...
Well, more or less.
There are no hidden snipers or anything in this community as far as you...
I thought there was a little later.
Okay, well, we'll hold on that thought. Hmm. Why don't you continue telling about the community, the town where you were at this point?
Well, my mortar squad, probably the whole mortar section, we wound up in this house. The guy had been a music teacher, and he had all kinds of instruments there. And the other ammo bearer, Joe Tilka, he played the piano, Boogie Woogie, on the black keys only.
Right.
And one of the guys in the squad had played a bass viol or something or other back when they had live music on the radio a little bit, some little Indiana station or something. Somebody else played a horn. And we had a jam session in there. The Germans all thought we was nuts, you know. Here's these stupid Americans.
The local residents, yeah.
Yeah. Making music out there, you know. But anyway, we left there.
Before you leave the town, how were you viewed by the civilian Germans who were residents? I mean, here you were, the occupiers.
I never ran into a real German. The Nazis were all on the other side of the river,
right.
Always. They might have a picture on the piano.
Oh, I see.
With the
it took me a minute to understand that statement, yes.
Picture on the piano of some young man, you know, and the woman says that's her husband. He's wearing a captain in the SS uniform, you know. And you're not a Nazi? No,
yes.
No, Nick's Nazi. Other side the Rhine.
Oh, my gosh.
Well.
All right, you were saying you were leaving the town.
Well, when we left the town, they gave us a meal. And always, you know, you had to clean up your mess gear. We just got done eating, and I hadn't noticed, but a big line of trucks had pulled up beside us. And they said, don't bother about washing the mess gear, just throw them in that pile and climb aboard. They wanted us, and they wanted us in a hurry.
Ooh.
And they moved us out a few miles under cover of a big strip mine. You know, there was a lot of tailings sticking up there, you know, so we weren't under observation. And we moved in there, and there's a firefight going on in there and on the other side. You know what I mean by a firefight. That's an active engagement when they're riflemen and so on are shooting at one another. And we're laying there waiting to get in, and I dug a hell of a hole. And I got to thinking about my cognac, you know. And I had tucked inside my field jacket, and I got to thinking, if a barrage comes in and you hit the dirt, you break it, not only do you get cut up, but you have lost the cognac. So I'm looking for a means of carrying it, and I finally had this inspiration. And I throwed away one round of mortar ammunition, and now that I've told this, Uncle Sam will probably bill me for that. It's just a perfect fit, except it was taller than the mortar round, and that gold seal was sticking up out of there. And as I said, this firefight was going on. We was laying beside a little railroad track. Apparently it went back into this quarry. And the first sergeant, a real tall, skinny guy, come running down there. And you could see bullets, tracers are hitting the rail, you know, and they didn't have it on him yet good yet. He went running by, and he slid to a stop and come back, and he said, what in the name of fornication is that? That gold seal?
Yeah.
I don't know. I give him some smart-ass answer, and he turned around and ran again.
He noticed that while he was running. Wow.
But he came back, but didn't make me throw it away. And the next morning, before daylight, well, we split it up amongst a squad or two. They're just a swallow apiece, you know, but after fighting all night, it was welcome, you know. And out there, we'd have, you might have one, two, three, or a dozen little firefights in a day, and we're going across the Cologne Plain.
So you were constantly pushing the Germans
further
deep into
the... All the First Army had the same orders, proceed to the Rhine River. And they had more or less an area they were to go in. And we were headed, the battalion, we hit the river about 4 miles upriver from Dusseldorf.
Oh.
And
so you made it to the river.
Yeah, the next to last day before we got there, I was riding the lead tank because I had these frostbite feet. Had all the mortars and ammo up there. Several riflemen were up there. And all of a sudden, a bridge blowed in front of us down the foot of the hill, across the little creek. A whole bunch of German tanks appear, and they're all shooting, and our tanks are shooting. And bullets are bouncing off that turret I'm leaning against. And I kicked all the mortars and the ammo off and took a dive for the ground. And the colonel had driven, somebody had driven him in his Jeep, his driver driven him clear up to the front of the column about, he's past us, when all exploded, you know. And the colonel bailed out and ran. And the driver, he was backing it out. That's all he could do on that little narrow road, zigzagging around these tanks. I thought he would turn it over. But the tanks, they fire a few rounds, and the one I was in, he was about the only one that had a good view, a good field of fire. He hit one German tank, knocked another one off the road, and there was a haystack out there a little ways. And I talked to this lieutenant later, and he said he was just shooting them as they came down the chute, you know, shoving them in the cannon. Mm-hmm. Wasn't picking out armor piercing like he should have been. Mm-hmm. And the next one that came down was a concrete piercing, and they throwed it in, fired it in that haystack. We saw it hit and went straight up in the air, you know. So then they throwed in an incendiary and burned a tank up in there.
Oh, the tank was in the haystack?
Yeah, they hid in there. So then they got out of there, and the riflemen had picked up their rifles and ran. Here's the mortar section out there, and a machine gunner or two, and a few guys that was clear to the front of the column right down over that bridge. And this machine gunner that I was talking about that turned white, he was out there, and he had a cloth belt, and it was raining. It thawed about 4 inches deep, and we're crawling around, and it's just slop, you know. And I was trying to pull on that belt. It wouldn't go automatic with it wet. And I think it was Roger Meyer was pushing on it, and I was pulling and trying. All he could get was singles. He had to keep pulling the bolt back. And I said, would he stay and get the guys out of there, you know, give them some fire, if I'd get him a can of ammo, ask him where his ammo barrel was? And he said, you see that lead foxhole down there by the bridge? And yeah, and he said, Panko dived into that. So I went down there, crawled down there, through all that slop. I get down there, and I'm in the ditch, and this German machine gunner, there was three of them down there, one direct front, and he could lay it on the side of the ditch, but he couldn't depress enough to get me where I was at. I was hollering at this guy to throw me a can of ammo, and all he said, screw you, can't hit me here. So I finally jumped up and rolled across the parapet, grabbed a can of ammo, and I was real mad, and I ran and just dive and reverse directions, you know, and sometimes I'd get up and run the same directions. The guys told me later they could see tracers going between my legs. And the next day I had a lot of burns on my clothes.
Holy mackerel.
And never drawed any blood. And while they was concentrating on me, why, two more of the mortar section got up and ran back, and there's a Germans had dug a tank trap back there in the highway, the road, it wasn't a highway. And they took cover there and set up a mortar. Neither one was the gunner, he didn't have the sight. But they just did it by guessing, by God. Walked it in, the third round, they was right on the Germans. And they put about 6 rounds on them, and they come out with their hands up. They was down there anywhere from 300 or 400 yards to 600 yards, maybe. And they come out of their holes in the railroad, or the road embankments there they was hiding behind, and come down the hill on their side. And these two guys were so PO'd at what, they were so muddy and wet and everything, they just cranked that mortar up and dropped the other 3 rounds in, right in the middle of them. Well, as they came back up, they jumped the creek, came across there, and was coming up the hill. And rifleman fell in behind them, was trailing them up there, and I thought, damn Germans will shoot their own men to get us, so I didn't go up the road following them. I cut around the hill, And there was a barn down there with an open shed on it, and it had stone pillars supporting this open shed, about three pillars, about 20 inches to 2 foot square. And as I come around the corner of the barn, two German soldiers, riflemen, jumped back in the doorway of the barn. I jumped behind that pillar, and then I couldn't figure out where to go from there.
I bet.
And I'm keeping looking to see how much of them is hanging out, you know. And along come a lieutenant with five or six guys. So we talked them into coming out and surrendering, those two Germans. And I went on around the hillside and rejoined the company. And the next morning we took off and jumped that creek and went up to the top of the hill. And it's level about, there was one hollow down there, level for 3 or 4 miles to the Rhine River.
Oh.
And the Germans are just putting rolling barrages across it. We went into a big old isolated farmhouse, had a courtyard around it and a wall, you know. And this German had dug him a Z-shaped trench, and he had laid boards and doors and stuff across, left an opening at each end of the Z, and then covered the dirt back over baled hay that he had over that. And you could enter from either end. And after shelling us for quite a while, you know, and wasn't getting on us, and all of a sudden it corrected. And it hit the roof of this big old, I think it was a three-story house probably, clay tile, brick building. And I was the fourth man or more that dived through that door in the last one. And everything, all my underwear and everything, the shirts was blowed up around my neck, so I had to be stretched out straight in the drive when that shock wave hit me, you know. And we come out, that yard was covered, it hit the right at the corner of the roof, and a big section of the wall and half of that clay tile roof was there in the yard. There wasn't anywhere that didn't have masonry, broken masonry on it, so if we hadn't got in there, we'd have probably been dead.
From shrapnel or?
From the brick bats flying and stuff.
What were the Germans firing?
We had 20-some German tanks backed up across the river, to the river there, and the bridge was blowed. They couldn't get across, and they was using them as artillery.
Right.
And there was probably stuff on the other side, too. Our company lost 40-some men that day, I know that. We lost just two or three, real lucky. And we waited till dark, but just before dark, somebody on our right moved out, at least company strength, and they had their Jeeps with them and everything. And they got out 100, 200 yards, and the Germans had them in their sights, and you seen Jeeps a-flying and everything else. We waited till dark, and then we went down to the bottom of this hollow down there, a mile or so out. And there was, I think, three tanks down there, of our tanks. And there was a house down there, and they was using it as a field hospital. Our medics were.
Mm-hmm.
And we finally decided along about midnight that we'd go in, and some of us would go in and change guards, you know. But somebody would always be available if we got called to get us out of there. So we found some of the guys opened the door and peeked at them doing surgery in there, you know, amputating legs and so on. And two of the guys went across the hall. This room we laid down in wasn't big enough for all of us to lay down. I think it was my squad sergeant. And it was either Joe Tilka or Little Joe, the section sergeant, went over there because I know that we hollered at them when they told us to was moving out. And my squad leader, he kind of wakes up, you know, somebody's called him, and there's somebody laying beside him, and he keeps nudging, saying, "Come on, Joe, come on, Joe." And Joe doesn't move, so he finally zipped his ronson, you know, and it was a dead woman. He'd been sleeping beside.
Oop.
She'd got killed by artillery the day before, apparently.
So this was a mortuary room.
Mortuary room, right. So he comes out kind of shook up. They told us we was going to attack, hit the town up there, a little town at the top of the hill above the slope to the river at 4 o'clock, and there's going to be a barrage begin. We was going to lay one on at a quarter till, and we'd lift at 4 o'clock. And we was to hit the town right behind it. Well, we get moving, and they told us the barrage was called off, so we was trotting down this little road, and somebody forgot to tell Cannon Company. And they just ran a line of them down both ditches, and we're running between it. A little narrow road. We ran into the town and laid down beside the houses, and roofing sliding off and everything. You know, the houses are getting hit. But we had an advantage.
They did barrage?
They what?
The barrage did occur?
Yeah.
Even though they told you it wouldn't?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Oh, my gosh.
But they forgot to tell Cannon Company that they weren't going to fire.
The ones that are doing the, okay.
Yeah. And at 4 o'clock, we was up and moving through the houses, rousted them out, and stayed there for several hours.
Now, you were rousting out German troops or German citizens?
Well, it's quite a few of the houses had a uniform hanging in them.
Okay.
Of course, they told us that no soldier, no Nazis all across the river.
Oh, gosh.
Anyhow, Roger come along and told me that we was having a potluck meal. Just bring a dish, you know. We'd all cook something. And so I went searching around, and this old Dutchman had locked everything, padlocks. So I just shooting him off my carbine. So he decided to unlock them, and I opened this one shed, and there was a big tom turkey in there. You know, I was ecstatic. I went and got Roger, and I said, "We can have turkey." And he looked at him, and he said, "I don't know." Said, "You know, we don't know how long we'll be here." Said, "He probably wouldn't be tender if we cooked him all day." So he said, "We better not." We wound up, we cooked some chickens and got fruit out of the cellars and all this, and potatoes, and had ourselves a real good meal. And then they trucked us back to town, and we stayed there overnight, and the next day they trucked us back a little further to a field, and the battalion was awarded a distinguished unit citation for the work they'd done the first part of the Battle of the Bulge. Well, I'm part of the battalion. I'm entitled to wear it while I'm with the battalion, but I didn't earn it. Do you understand me? But it's a decoration I can wear when I'm with the battalion.
Right.
So we just got back to town, and the 9th Armored, I think it was, had found that Remagen Bridge and crossed it.
Oh, yeah.
So that night they put us on trucks and headed us up a river. We went with the headlights on and everything. And I had liberated a little old lap robe, I guess you'd call it. And it was colder than hell, and I'd wrap that around me and then put my poncho on over that and stay fairly warm. They moved us by truck, I think, to a town called Ringen. It was maybe 20 miles or a little less from Remagen. We stayed there overnight. And the next day we walked through to Remagen and that Ludendorff Bridge. Well, the Germans had blowed, as we're facing it, the right-hand girder at the far end, and it's hanging on one. We'd moved jeeps and tanks across, and there's a lot of holes in the floor. The engineers keep patching it. And when we crossed, they told us there's a major shell going through there every 32 or 3 seconds. And it was 1,068 feet long, I think I've read. And it was the longest bridge in the world. There was shrapnel ricocheting around through there, and they was laying indirect machine gun fire on it.
The Germans,
and every little bit they'd bomb it, you know. We started out in groups of 5, and they said, "Walk, don't run." Well, that's the opposite of what Roger and I always do. You know, you run until you can walk and get out of the officers. seeing you when we got in trouble, you know. But anyway, here we are walking across, and I was fifth man. And the lead man was walking slower and slower and slower, and we got about a third of the way across. I saw him turn around and look at those towers. You probably saw pictures of that Ludendorff Bridge. Had towers at each end, on each side. And he looked at safety behind him, and then he looked to the front, and cut and ran. We all followed. And after I got across, I watched other units, and every one of them done the same thing at about the same place.
Oh, my.
And the rest of the division had turned and went right and went up the hill to the right and instantly went into combat. My battalion turned and went left and went up and plugged a gap between, I don't know, 77 or 78th, the Lightning Division, and I think it was that 9th Armored. And we was up there 2-3 days. And we had a few casualties due to this anti-aircraft stuff falling on us. They was lined up a mile on each side of that bridge, bumper to bumper, quad 50s and all this. And they were shooting so much that they would have to take a shovel and shovel the hulls, those 50 calibers, out of those half-track bodies, because they'd pile up in there and they couldn't stand. I saw them piled up deeper in the treads, you know, on that half track.
My gosh.
On the sides.
The half track is a self-mobile gun, you mean?
It's a, well, it could be anything. They had quad 50s mounted on these. They hauled a infantry squad or some kind of weapon.
And that weapon fired so much that it was
they
sort
was
of piled up in
quad
its own
50
debris.
So
yeah.
much
yes.
that the hull, empty hulls would pile up till they had to shovel them out with there with a shovel.
Yeah.
We went up there and stayed a couple of days, and I figured it was my brother's birthday of the 13th. I thought I was there. I wrote him a letter. I remember that, and they moved us out that next morning. And they had found a building with a whole cellar full of alcoholic beverages in it, and they put battalion headquarters there and was releasing one bottle per squad per day. And one of the guys in the second mortar squad, I think, he got peeved at somebody or other. So he was a pretty good scrounger, and he was going back and coming back every little bit with a bottle and a case of 10-1 rations. Well, we opened the 10-1s and took out all the good stuff and had all we wanted to drink, and I was always pretty careful. I did not want to be drunk and under fire, you know. I wanted to know what I was doing. Well, the colonel got mad. They was all a lot of them drunk, so he made us walk instead of trucking us down to the other end of that bridgehead to sober them up. Mm-hmm. And they lined us all up, and we had to empty our canteens. Mine just had water in it anyway, and then they had a lot of jerry cans with water in them. You went down one side of this table and filled your canteen, you know, and corked your back up. And a few guys was going down the other side of the table. There's some jerry cans over there. Well, when we got to where we was going up there, where we was going to jump off towards the Stumper Ridge Quarry, and the colonel said, those bastards drunker than they were before they started, said, where are they getting it? And George Prager had been in charge of seeing that they filled the canteens with water. And one guy said, well, I don't know, but said, George could probably enlighten us. His friends was all filling up with jerry cans of booze he had over there, you know.
I saw that coming.
Anyway, we go up this big long hill. It's all brush, rocks, and little pine stuff are growing we had to drag through. One place we have to crawl through down brush. We get up there and I don't know, one of the sister battalions had tried it the day before and hadn't been able to clean it out, and we try it. And I dug in under a tree, and you don't never do that if you can help it, because tree bursts come in. A mortar around hits the leaves on a tree. It's what you call an instantaneous fuse. The leaf on a tree will blow it. Well, I dug in, and the Germans had been shelling us from the time we got there at 11 or 12 o'clock for 2 or 3 hours, and they was going over and down the hill, going behind us, wasn't hurting us. And all of a sudden, some screaming Mimis come in. You know what they were? That was a rocket they had fired like a, in a case, like a mortar, great big thing. And it was mostly tin, didn't have much shrapnel. It was more explosive. Mm-hmm. And there was a medic walking across the area there, and it looked like one must have lit 20 feet. And he just went up real easy, seemed like. I'm watching him. And he went up twice his height, I would guess, and turned over a couple of times and come down hard. And I crawled over to where he was and couldn't find any blood or anything. He's conscious. And he was knocked just plumb silly. He's saying stuff like, "I think I'd feel better if I had something to eat." And I scratched out a hole right there beside him and rolled him into it. And I had just started carrying down logs and stuff to cover my hole so to protect from tree burst. I just got him in there and went back to mine. And I was sitting up in this trench I'd dug. I'd went down to rock or real hard stuff anyway. It was less than 30 inches deep, I would say. And you stand behind a mortar and watch your round go out. You can watch it till it's too small to see. I'm sitting there and I looked up and I seen this speck coming in. And I let out a yell. I don't know whether I just hollered or hit it or incoming or what. And I slid down flat on my back and it hit tree limb above me. And I got hit. And
so you're lying on your back.
I'm lying flat on my back. I'm sure I would have been dead. I'd have just been busted in two if I'd been sitting up, you know. But the ground absorbed that shock, you know. I mean, I'm pressed against it. I know I was pushed down awful hard. Couldn't figure out why I couldn't sit up. Trying to hold the pressure point on my right thigh there. And hollered for a medic and hollered for the squad sergeant, told him I was hit. And another medic come running up, not our company medic. And he split my pants leg open. I said, "Do I need a tourniquet?" And he said, "No, there's no blood. But you got a hole about the size maybe of a silver dollar right through." And shrapnel sometimes, they told me later, a bullet never. But shrapnel sometimes will cuff the ends of the veins back inside, and it's hot and it will seal it off.
They're cauterized by the
shrapnel. Cauterized and cuffed the veins in.
Holy mackerel.
And the docs told me that's why I wasn't dead in 1 minute.
A miracle.
Yeah, I was. And they laid it right on us, and Cannon Company did too, they discovered later. We lost over 50% of the company.
And that one attack of the one mortar attack?
That what?
That one attack, artillery attack, mortar?
Cannon Company, 50% of the company, our company. That's what they call friendly fire.
Yes, unfriendly fire, mm-hmm. Yes.
So anyway, I'm laying there, I can't get out of this hole, and I finally just, the company picked up and ran. That's all they could do, what was left of them. And there's a lot of yelling going on around me, I hear. As my squad go running back, they stopped a second and told me they'd be back for me. And it was, this was March the 14th, I figured, and possibly the 15th, but I was sure it was the 14th. And it was mid-afternoon, I thought. Sun was up pretty high. When I got to aid station, I've forgotten, but I think it was 1 o'clock in the morning, 1 or 3, somewhere
so
in there.
So they did come back for you?
They did come back for me. And they tried making a litter out of field jackets and a couple of rifles. And I couldn't stand to be doubled up then, or maybe it's a raincoat they had. And I couldn't stand to be doubled up. My leg was just completely disconnected, you know. So I hopped down that hill between two men. Through that brush and hit a ditch and drag out. And they drug me through that brush. We got to the foot of the hill and I said, forget it. I was just completely wore out, you know. So two guys stayed guard and two went back for a litter. And they were gone, I think, several hours, and they came back and they had a litter, and this hill's steep enough. The four guys carried with one hand and one claw on the hill. And it was steep enough, I slid off of it several times, hanging on best I could. We got to the top of the hill and they had a Jeep. Somebody said, where'd you get that? And they said, they stole it at a regiment. It was equipped with a litter carrier across
the... They stole it for you, basically.
Yeah, they did.
Well, how courageous.
It was equipped with a rack across the hood, and they put me on there. And there's strictly no lights. And so one guy sat on the front of the hood with his feet on the bumper, and I could hear these tanks running. They had to keep detouring around them. He'd holler, hard right, or hard left, or stop, 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 you know. I got back to battalion aid station, and the surgeon asked me my name, and by that time I was going to sleep pretty good. And I remember telling him, Matthews of the 99th. And he said, no, the whole thing. And I gave him name, rank, serial number, and APO. And I heard him say, back with no splints. And I went out like a light. And the next thing I remembered, duly, but I remembered later being in a shock tent, I think. And I think the only thing you hear there is transfusions dripping, the blood dripping, if you can hear that. And maybe a moan once in a while, but they was carrying me up these steps into a something they was using as a hospital. And they set me on the table, some kind or other, on this litter. Put a blood pressure cuff on my left arm, and they kept checking my blood pressure, and it'd get up about that high, I thought. It's an old mercury job, you know. I kept rolling my eyes over and looking at it, and kept coming back, and finally I opened my eyes, and some captain was turning away, and he said, here's another waste of time. I come to in a hurry. Give him a good cussing, of course.
Why did he say that, I wonder?
I was dead.
From what? From the loss of all of the blood?
Yeah.
Wow.
But anyway, he come back and he said, you're lucky, I got a little time to waste. And pretty soon he come back with a big, great, big old syringe and looked to me like there was a green fluid in it. He just stuck it in the tube and squirted it in there, and he pumped up that cuff, and I watched the blood pressure going up like this. They took me in the operating room, and they explained to me the procedure. You know, he said, I'm going to take the shrapnel out. I had a hole through, but I had a piece about the size of my little finger still in there. he said, we're going to give you ether, and he said, put this cone over your face. You take two deep breaths, and then when I tell you, you take two shallow. I took my two deep breaths, and that was the worst mistake ever made, I thought, because there wasn't nothing. And he said, now two shallow, and I was out. And the next thing I know, they was flying me back to an airfield at Paris, heading back to England. And they put us in this hospital, transit hospital they had there I forget what they called them then, gas evacs or something or other. And I remember him picking I and another guy up, two fellas did, and took us into a vacant ward. Set us down. Was there a couple hours, I reckon, and some people burst into the room. What in the hell are you doing in here? And said, we've been holding up a shipment for you. We was going by plane to England. Well, we didn't have any choice. They carried us in there, you know. They put us on a, I don't know, it was a C-46 or C-47. If you ever rode one, they take off by a series of hops.
Oh.
Keep getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and then they finally get one that'll make them airborne. And you land the reverse, you know, a great big one and a smaller one and smaller till they can hold the wheels on the ground. And I don't know where we landed, but then I rode a train across England to just about to Wales. And we was, I think, 8 miles from the Welsh border, they told us. And I was in an old English-built hospital there. It had three stoves in the ward to heat it. And they kept it cold.
If I may interrupt, before we continue, I don't want you to forget, but I'd like you to, as you think back on the service on the continent, we were talking earlier off camera about your experiences as a new man in an experienced troop and what the way the Army trained the infantry during this period.
Yeah.
I would hope you could comment on that in your own experience.
They give us this, what they called infantry replacement training.
Mm-hmm.
And you were supposed to be able to take any position, and you know, in a rifle squad or whatever. And you supposedly fired all the weapons. And it's a horrible method. You need to train with the people you're going to fight with. I mean, this is my opinion. But the guys I went up to, they was treated me real good.
But you were, instead of being a whole unit that had trained together, you were a new boy,
yeah,
newly trained person going with veterans? Is that the system?
Yes, uh-huh. Oh. They'd been there since November the 13th, and it was about the 20th of January when I got there. And they'd went through the major battle of the Battle of the Bulge.
And how did they treat you? How did they treat you?
Real good, most of them, you know. They tried to give me suggestions and all this, and tell me where to dig in and everything.
So they did accept you as...
They did accept me real well. Most of those guys were from Army Specialized Training that had got transferred into the 99th when they disbanded the ASTP. And took them as infantry soldiers, and they had went to, I think the 99th Division was in training then at Paris, Texas, and they'd went down on the Louisiana maneuvers, and some of the guys told me that they preferred combat to the Louisiana maneuvers.
Oh my.
They was down there in the spring, and it was flooded. They said the bull alligators were roaming up and down Company Street. And the water was knee-deep.
Oh, my.
But I go up alone in this mortar section, and Roger got into the section runner.
Right.
But we saw each other most days.
Okay.
But I never knew there was so much distance between squad level out there and the CP until years after the war when I got back together with Roger. And what they was feeding us that week, I was there at Halfen, that what I got of a morning, we got two meals, of a morning was either three little pancakes made with flour, and we used Dr. Lyon's tooth powder for baking powder. Gives it a mini flavor, but it rises.
Oh, my God.
And syrup was sugar, boiled water, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Or two slices of French toast, and night we got some Spam, some dehydrated potatoes, or some sea ration hash and some dehydrated potatoes. I weighed 165 pounds when
you
I went
over. You
said
there was a big difference between that?
Well, Roger
CP?
Was back at
yeah.
the CP, and he told me he thought he held the European championship on pancake eating.
They had more than three, they
eat. He had all he wanted.
Oh, no. I see.
there I was eating three little pancakes about so big.
You were just going to say what your weight was when you did this.
When I got back to the States and they cut me out of that double spiker, the doc said, "What do you weigh, son?" And I said, 165 pounds, you know, real confident, because that's what I did. And he looked me over laying there in a half shell, you know. And he said, "I'll tell you what I'm going to do." He said, "I'm going to give you the benefit of the doubt. I'm going to put you down to 120.
Well, before we get that far, I interrupted you when you were just at that hospital on near the Welsh border.
Yeah.
So why don't you start there about what happened?
Okay, we're there, and they took me in the first morning. I was one of the quick patients, but they told me, said, "Don't worry about dying. We've never lost a battlefield patient if they got back this far." And they took me in and cut the cast off of me that I was in. And they had me about halfway knocked out, you know, sleeping pill and all. And this sergeant started up here with the cast cutters going down, and he got down about here. And I said, "Hey, you know, take it easy. There's a wound down there." And he kept going, and I started cussing him, and they hit that needle and put me out. But when I come to that night, my right leg was stretched out over the side of the bed and up like this. That was that, your feet elevated, bed rest. But I could see this metal clevis thing down at my knee, and they had put a bath towel over my leg to keep it from getting too cold. And I laid there and idly wondered, how in the hell does that thing hang onto my knee? Well, the next morning I discovered there was what you call a Kirchner wire drilled right through, you know, and attached to that.
Well, the Kirchner wire driven through the bones in your body?
Yeah, they drilled it right through just above the knee joint. Supposedly, mine went down through the joint and got infected.
Oh, no.
But anyway, I had osteomyelitis so bad that the personnel would come down the aisle and they'd get to the fore side and they said, "It ain't that we don't like you, it's that we just can't stand you." I smelled so bad, bone rotting away there, you know. Mm-hmm. And they was giving me penicillin shots around the clock, and they finally, my temp was up there, they thought I'd be brain damaged, probably am, but or die, you know. They put a rubber sheet under me, and they'd taken I don't know how much penicillin, they put in a 1,000 cc flask, filled it with sterile water, and had a tube there with a clamp on it just dripping in that wound, and catch it with this rubber sheet. It was supposed to last 8 hours, and it was cold, you know. And probably after about 6 hours, I couldn't stand it no more, and I'd reach up, and it wouldn't hurt nothing if I opened it just a little. Pretty soon, I'd give it another turn, you know, empty it out, and I'd come back. We thought it would last 8 hours. It must have ran too fast, nurse.
So at times they were concerned that you wouldn't survive.
Right.
Were there times where they were concerned your leg wouldn't survive and they might have to amputate?
The first doc had told me I wouldn't survive an amputation at that time. And when the doc cast me up to leave the hospital in England, he told me he thought I was going to break his record. And I wasn't thinking. I said, "What's record's that?" And he said, "I thought you were going to die on me." And I said, "Oh, no, I never worried about dying after I once got to the hospital. I thought Paul was going to die," and that was the guy that come in and he'd joined the 99th, my division, taking him up as a replacement, and they was fighting in a town. And after dark, they took him up, and he said, the sergeant told us we was on one side of the street, and the Germans was in the basement on the other side. We was firing across the street. He said he got lost, went down the wrong street, and we ran into some German soldiers. And he turned and ran, and the Germans managed to kill a sergeant. Paul killed one of the Germans, but he got shot through the leg just above the knee. And he didn't know where to go. He laid there in the street the rest of the night. He took off his belt and put it on as a tourniquet and didn't loosen it, you know. laid there all the next day, and he said, the next night I figured I had to do something. So he decided which way, thought it sounded like the right kind of rifles firing, and he crawled that way and tumbled in a basement. And he guessed right, he was back in 99th control. But anyway, he'd left it too long, and our captain, the surgeon, was a wonderful man. He'd come in the middle of the night to check on you, you know. And Paul was there probably second night, and he come in, old Worthington turned on the lights, and his nose went up. And he hollered at the nurse, and he said, call surgery. Come back there and throw back the blanket and sniffed, and said, get that gurney here right now. And a gas gangrene had set in, and they had to amputate.
Did that save his life?
Yeah.
Oh, good. So the doctor said he was worried you were going to break his record, but you
didn't.
Yeah,
I was going to die.
And you...
And he said, oh, no, Paul was never in any real danger. He said, you know, once we got his leg off. But there was the infection I had was different. It was osteomyelitis. And yeah. I had a swelling about so big, and it just looked like bone there. You have four sets of muscles, the quadriceps down the top of your thigh. I got part of one left. The nerves are all screwed up. The blood vessels are all screwed up. Over the course of not too long afterwards, the hair all came in, ingrown hair, down the side of my leg, a place about so wide from the knee to the wound. And when I'd pull them out of there, you know, they'd make a little pimple. It's like somebody stabbed you with a ice pick just anywhere on that thigh. You didn't know where, but you was going to get stabbed because those nerves were all screwed up. But anyway, I laid there for 8 weeks in traction, and finally the wound healed up. Well, was still draining just a little, but mostly healed up. And they put me in a cast to ship me out. And after the first few weeks, when I got over that worst infection, you know, got tired of sleeping and all this. We had a character in there, and I thought he was about 18. I don't know what he was, but apparently he had some kind of a musical education, and they had the intercom, and they'd play requests. Well, we was hearing One Meatball. Do you ever hear that?
Yeah.
And Busted Valentine and all this kind of stuff. And I told old Slim, this guy that knew a little bit about music, I said, take a request down there for me. I want to hear some country western. And he wanted something classical. And so he figured out all kinds of classical stuff. And you had to sign a request and turned them in. And the guy down there on the radio, he said, well, boy, they got some musicians in there for all of this stuff, you know, for Brahms and Bach and all this stuff. And he did play a little bit of country western, not much. Not too much classical. Like I said, it was all One Meatball. Ooh, that was a horrible song. Particularly when you heard it five times a day, you know. And old Slim had been hit. He'd lost most of his shoulder blade, maybe all of it. And he could move his arm like this with it hanging down, you know. But he could move it to the elbow, but he couldn't move the upper arm. And they're telling him how good he's going to be, you know, how good they're going to fix him up. And he's trying to pin them down, so they're in there one day, and he said, will I be able to do this and do that? And they're saying, yeah, yeah, yeah. And he said, play the piano? And they said, yeah. And he said, that's damn funny. I never learned how to play the piano yet.
Oh, I don't believe.
Yeah, that happened.
Oh, amazing.
And we were a bad group.
That's such a classic story. That's great.
Oh, I got one more story you got to hear about this.
Go right ahead.
Ward. They had an overflow group in a tent out there. And there was at least three guys out there. And they didn't have to be, but they preferred it out there.
Oh.
And the ward was so not more than half or two-thirds full. But they could go out a side door and go to this tent. And it apparently had a fence around it like a stockade. There was a gate they could get out. And these guys' English girlfriends got to coming and spending the night.
Oh, my.
Yeah, illegal. So one night the MPs raided. And a bunch of the MPs come through the gate, and two come through the ward, was telling us, shush, you know. And they get back there to the door, the ones bust in on the other side. Well, they nailed two guys and their girlfriends. And the one, the third guy, he comes through the ward, door into the ward, and he just tramped down these two MPs and walked right over them.
Huh?
Had his gal friend by the hand and outstreaked out through the ward. You talk about streaking, they streaked.
Uh-oh.
Well, the MPs was going to make us identify them. I didn't know them anyway. Hell, I'd seen them go through, but I didn't know them. But we all told them that when they brought guys in, you know, they had a uniform on or pajamas or something. And we said, well, we couldn't identify them that way, but if they'd make them take off their clothes. Of course, that didn't fly, you know. But anyway, we stayed there. I stayed there 8 or 10 weeks and then got trained up through Scotland and came back on the Aquitania, the world's third largest passenger ship. And it couldn't get even into the port to the pier there. And they had to take us out on lighters, small boats, you know. And I don't remember if they had a something or other inside the ship, the opening that was down with the level where we was or not. But anyway, we was taken aboard there, and I was clearing this right in the very center of the ship. We got back to New York. We came in 5 1/4 days.
Oh, what did it take you, 15 days to go?
15 days going across, 5 1/4 coming back. We pulled into New York, and the guys were all at the poorhouse, screaming and hollering, and there was all kinds of ferry boats and everything out there greeting them, you know. And they were, one of these tugboats.
Were they greeting the ship, or they were greeting the returning service?
They were greeting us, you know, ship load of
service people.
And there was a whack out there on a ferry boat doing a strip.
Up, up, up.
And they wouldn't even get me to a porthole.
Oh,
carry me.
How mean.
Yeah. And all them guys describing it, you know, they turn around and holler at me and then look again. But anyway, we wound up at Halloran General Hospital.
Where is that located?
In New York City, somewhere there. And it was a hospital where they shipped you to all places. And
now, is this late 1945?
No, this was, that would have been early June 45.
Oh, that early, okay. So the war is still going on in the Pacific?
Still going on in the Pacific. Okay. But it ended in, what, May the 2nd or something rather in Europe. Anyway, why, they loaded up 600 orthopedic patients and put them on a train, and we headed out, and then they told us we were headed for Bruns General Hospital in Santa Fe, New Mexico. And as somebody said, there ain't no such place. And it was about that bad. It was an old TB hospital. And we got there, we didn't even have a surgeon. And after several days, some doctor came in, introduced himself, and he said, I'm just a temporary. He said, I'm a baby specialist, but I'm here to fill in till you get your orthopedic surgeon and the group here, you know. And a few days later, the nurse told us we had major so-and-so. And I said, who in the hell's that? And she said, he is one of the best bone surgeons in the U.S. And before I left her, I said, God help the U.S. We has got a problem, you know. Anyway, my leg had kind of knitted together a little bit. And it was like taking two tubefores and separating them an inch, say, or an inch and a half. And then taking a 4-inch block on the backside and spiking through. Well, you know how much strength that it'd have, but it did hold it in line. Well, I had this stiff knee that had had the infection in and been in traction and in a cast. And they had a major come through, and he was going to get everybody out of bed. And that's a wonderful sentiment, and I agree with it, but he was going to bend my knee. And that didn't work. I told him it wouldn't, and he throwed his weight on it. And I heard it snap, and I kicked him off and told him he'd broke my leg, and he said, "Nonsense, you're just yellow." And he left, and I went back to bed and laid down on the bed, and boy, I could see that leg shorten up every day, and it got out of line, you know, it wasn't straight no more. And I'm hollering, I finally got somebody to fake the doc's signature on an x-ray order, and they brought the portable in there and x-rayed my leg. Well, they had rounds every Saturday, and I look at it, but the docs don't, because they hadn't ordered any x-ray. And it's no doubt, you know, it had shifted way over out of line. So finally, this surgeon told me he was going to give me a bone graft. And he went in there, and all he did was cut it in two and took me back to bed, put me in traction, and put a lot of weights pulling all directions. And I didn't have any hot shrapnel to cuff the veins in or anything. That all pulled open. I had two cotton-felted mattresses on that bed. And the guy next to me was a bed patient too, and he said, "I heard liquid running." And he looked between the beds. He told me the next day this, you know. And he said, "I couldn't see nothing. I thought maybe you had a water pitcher hid out in your table or something." He said, "I finally got my head under the bed, and it was blood running through so fast you could hear it hit the floor." Ooh. He hollered for the nurse, and the ward man come running and went and got a tourniquet and put on me, and he got the nurse. And they dumped, I think, 5,000 cc's of blood in me that afternoon. That's all you hold. And they put me in this skin traction, and you never heard of that, and I never did before or since. They shaved my leg 10,000 times, 5,000 against the grain, you know. And then they put something on it that smelled just like gasket shellac that we used to use, remember? Mm. And then they had a wooden sole, and it had a recessed hole right in the middle of the arch. There was a rope knotted there and went out through a pulley over the foot of the bed, and they had 15 pounds of BBs in there. Well, this is New Mexico, and this is late summer, and it's hot and no air conditioning. And first full day, I'm on fire, and the second day, that turned to one water blister and all turned loose and slid off on the floor. And them BBs, I could hear them bouncing all over. The nurse did too. She came out of the station and looked at there at all of that mess and said, "What on earth are we ever going to do with you?" And turned around and walked away.
What?
So they come put me in what they called shoe traction. And all it did, it pulled my toes down, and I couldn't stand that, so I'd slide down against the foot of the bed and rest my foot up and go back up. And they was going to bend this leg, you know, get it in shape. That's for the doc gave me the operation. And so I got ahead of myself a little there. And they had me in a framework there that had this cloth, like a hammock in it, their leg rested in. And they had this pad against the side of my leg fastened on there. You could screw it in. It was going to move it a little every day. Well, all it did, you're in a loose hammock thing. Well, all it did, slide it over. So I screwed it clear in, and I'd try to lunge against it and break my leg and couldn't do it. All I could do was black out.
I would think so.
And I was feeling pretty low, I'll tell you. Well, anyway, finally he operated, you know, and cut it in two, and had osteomyelitis again and a broken leg again. Anyway, it finally knitted up, and they got the osteomyelitis under control. He went in and gave me a bone graft. And 2 weeks, they took an x-ray, and it began to look like milk in there, you know, in between them two ends of the bone. And 6 weeks, they made a brace for me, a long leg brace, didn't have any knee joint. But I walked on a ring on my hip bone there, and I had down there, and it had a pin thing through the heel of my shoe, and my heel was buffed about that fur out of the shoe. And the brace maker got the brace made, and they told me they didn't have a pair of shoes that would fit me. me. And I gave the nurse a $20 bill and sent her downtown, and she bought me a pair of shoes.
Gosh.
And I left there, still a bed patient. They wouldn't let me wear it out of there. And carrying this brace. And they put me on a litter and took me over to Lamy. The Santa Fe, Atchison, Topeka, and Santa Fe doesn't go through Santa Fe. It goes through Lamy, 4 miles away.
Okay.
So they took me over there, and at midnight, 11 o'clock at night, they put me on this train. I had two attendants, and they were drunk. They'd been in Mexico and come back with a barracks bag full of tequila. And the porter and the conductor removed a window. You can't take a litter aboard. It will make the turn. Yeah. They took out this window and took me in this compartment I had. And the porter took care of me for 3 days or whatever it took, close to that, to Galesburg, up to Mayo General. Oh. That was the name of the Army hospital there. We got there in the middle of the night, and they reversed the process, removed the window, and sent me out on the platform, and the train drove away. And I'm on a litter laying on the platform. There's a night light in the station, and there ain't nobody there.
What?
And I don't know whether it was just dew or mist and a little rain, but I had a blanket and pajamas, and I thought daylight come, I'll roll over at the door.
I think we need another tape.
Okay.
Give you a chance to catch your breath. Okay, you're in the mist in Galesburg. Oh, my. You were talking about the fact that you had been left at the station on the transfer from Texas to Illinois. I'd like to go back a step. How did it come about that you were moving from the hospital in the Southwest to the hospital in Illinois?
Well, I'd had several transfers, but wasn't carried through, you know. The only way you could get a transfer was for, unless it was specialized treatment, was for humanitarian reasons. And the reason we gave was so my folks could visit me. And it'd go through, you just get some politician, any congressman can get it done for you. But then it'd always get blocked, and they'd say I wasn't able to travel or something or other. And I'd say, well, you shipped me how many thousand miles to get me here? Now I've regressed. I can't travel 2,000 miles to get home or less, you know. But anyway, it hung there, and they really gave me a hard time over it. And I finally wrote to Senator Brooks, and I made charges against the hospital, and I could have proved every one of them. I had the witnesses, several guys that had got some real bad treatments, you know. I mean, it really hurt them. And old Curly Brooks got up on the floor of the Senate and asked for a senatorial investigation of the hospital.
Ooh.
Mm-hmm. And, of course, the medical corps told him that it wouldn't be necessary because it was surplus to their needs and they were going to close it anyway. But we still had an allied military group of doctors that went through and gave every one of us a physical, and we got a chest x-ray. And then the IGs came. And by this time, old Curly had worked on the Surgeon General, and I had orders. They had 10 days to have me on transportation to Mayo General at Galesburg, Illinois. And I wasn't about to foul that up. But anyway, these IGs come through, and it was just normal. They talked, you know, come through the ward and went down the line, and it's a captain, and he's got, I think, a sergeant for a stenographer, you know, taking it down. Anybody got any complaints, anything at all, you know? And so I said, no, sir, no complaints at all. Well, he knew he was looking for her, but he left, and about an hour later, here come a major. And he stopped up at the front, and the nurse pointed at me, you know? Mm-hmm. And he come back there and asked me, did I have any complaints? I would be protected. I said, no, sir, I had nothing to say. And he left, and pretty soon here come a colonel.
Whoa.
And he promised me the moon and $2 and anything he could think of. And I said, no, sir. Because it was getting closer every day, you know. And it was that 10th day at 11 o'clock at night when they took me over to Lamy. They had 10 days to get me on transportation. It's 10th day at 11 o'clock at night when they took me over to Lamy and put me on that train. And that's how I got out of there.
So they got you through the window, into the train, through the window, onto the platform, and now what happens?
Okay, I ride to Galesburg, and they stop there in the middle of the night, reverse the process, and, you know, he puts two ends of the litter on there and runs outside while the other guy holds it, and then they carry it through to there, and that guy comes out and gets it in, you know, and they set her down there, and they get back aboard, and the train drives away, and I lay there. And I look at that nightlight and I think, well, when somebody comes to work, I'll get over there. I'll roll over there or crawl or something. And it probably wasn't very long, but it seemed like a long time. And I seen headlights come flashing up there. And two guys got out and they had a flashlight and they come down the line there and hollered. So I hollered back. They come down there and shined the light on me and they said, are you the patient? And I looked around, didn't see nobody else. So I said, yeah. So they put me in their ambulance and took me out to the hospital. And they put me in a bed. The next morning, they carried me breakfast. Nurse come around after breakfast, and I said, how do I get a pass out of here? And she said, you don't get a pass out of here if you have to eat breakfast in bed. Said, you have to go down to the mess hall. Well, I had taken a practice swing or two with that long leg brace down at Brun's, but not officially, you know. And I said, well, when I get cleaned up here, then you point me in the right direction and I'll be there in time for lunch, wherever it is. But I never went after about once or twice. I'd go down to the PX and eat my meals. It was lots closer. I wouldn't get up and make my bed. I'd come back once from a weekend pass, and they wouldn't let me in the ward. Somebody had carried in these little crawly creatures, you know.
Oh.
They was spraying everything with kerosene. So they sent me down to another ward, and the only room they had, only bed they had, was the private room. Oh. So I had it made, you know. I'd go down and drink ice cream soda for breakfast, and stuff like that. And mostly I just went home, come back to sign the payroll, and go home again. And
how would you get home? Were your parents picking you up?
No. I don't know, 135 miles maybe from Galesburg. I'd get on the bus and ride the Greyhound, ride it to Springfield.
So you were that mobile now?
Yeah, I was that mobile. I talked the doc into that pass that first day, and he said no, you know, and I said, I'm going home in the morning. So he wrote a pass, and I went down to the bus depot, took a taxi down there. You know how high that first step is on a Greyhound bus?
Very, probably.
And I've practiced a little bit the day before on these crutches and long leg brace, and I stood there and finally got balanced and got my left leg up, crawled up there and got on inside. Started back, and there wasn't room enough to sit down at those seats with that long leg brace on, you know, my leg out like this. I went clear to the back, and there was a row of seats clear across the back, so I sat there with my leg up, taking up all of it. So there was people, they sold every ticket, every seat. Some people had to stand, and they'd stand there and say, I guess he wants all those seats, and I sit there to Springfield accustomed them, saying, yes, I want all these seats.
Were you in uniform?
Yeah.
Okay.
Had my crutches and my brace and all that. But as I said, I loafed around there for mostly for three months. And they never give me any therapy or anything, no treatment of any kind. And they issued me one uniform. And one time they took us over to the U of I over here to, I think they had the Big Ten track meet over here that year. And I watched Herb McKinley set a new world's record with a quarter mile. We was on a, like a Greyhound bus, Army bus. Our driver wasn't checked out in it. Were you familiar with Franklin Street Bridge in Peoria?
No, I don't.
Oh. Had a crook in it. He hit both sides, coming and going. Scraped it.
Add excitement to the trip.
Well, he had an excuse going back. We were all drunk. Oh. Including him.
Well, why was the Army keeping you in if they weren't doing anything for you?
I don't know. Maybe they didn't want us out. But anyway, I'd go home, come back. I went home on one, was feeling a lot better, and I left my long leg brace at home. Went back with my crutches. The next time I went back with one crutch, and the next time with no crutch, hobbled in, and I got myself two canes and carried them for a few days, and then one cane. Took a couple of canes home. I still got them around there, one of them at least.
So you were doing your own therapy, basically?
Doing my own therapy. Try to bend my knee. I'd sit on the edge of the bed and I'd take a, like a gym bag and weight it down and put it across my foot and try to pull it down. Get up and throw all my weight on it and I couldn't make it bend very much. I worked it loose a little and it soon tightened back up. But I had full range of motion in my hip at that time. I had good balance and I thought I could do anything anybody else could do except bend this knee. And finally, they told us they were going to give us a CDD, Certificate of Disability Discharge. And some of the medics told us, said, don't sell out too cheap. Well, I didn't know what the hell they was talking about. I got out with 50% disability. And that was $33 a month back then, every month, whether you needed any money or not, you know. But they lined us all up and went down to this place where they were having an interview for the CDD, and this guy comes out and they told him, they'd looked at the papers and how they had them stacked up. And he called my name, I went in next and reported, and I'd even forgotten how, you know, but you, Matthews, Private Wesley D, serial number reporting for, as ordered, sir. He said, ah, yes, and they're standing there talking, there's a couple of Air Force officers. And they're talking about horse racing and girls and all of this and getting drunk. And finally they looked around down there again and said, Private, ah. And I said, Matthews. And they said, Private Matthews, that it is the decision of this board to grant you a CDD, if that's okay with you. And I said, okay.
Did they also determine the percentage?
No, that had been determined somewhere.
Oh.
By the VA, I think. And so we had about a week of going through the, all the exams you had to, you know, and signing out and everything. And that last day when we was to go get our discharges signed and get out of there, I think about 9:30 of the morning, and there was transportation everywhere. They could have went to St. Louis, Chicago, Peoria, Springfield, and the commander of the detachment was getting a haircut. And the time he got back and signed the discharges, everything had gone through and there was nothing till night. And I took mine and called a cab and went out to the edge of town, to the Y. Stood there thumbing either way. People said, which way you want to go? And I said, I don't give a damn. Peoria's fine, Springfield's fine, better. And I got a ride down to Lewiston, and then I thumbed a guy with a one of these trucks. He was servicing cigarette machines. Oh. And he said, I'm going to Springfield, but it's a long route. He said, I'm going through Lincoln, and then Clinton, and then back to Springfield, another stop or two. But he said, I'll take you there. And he took me right to the bus station. I called my aunt. There wasn't any phone service down to the place where my folks lived. She come, got me, and took me home. And I had swore the day after I got home from the service I was going to go fishing. And the old North Fork, a mile from me down there at Roby, was clear bank full. You couldn't even get to it to go fishing, but I went down and went on the other side, and B.O. had a little spur line that ran from Springfield to Decatur, and they had a water tower there for those steam trains, and there was a box down there where the pump was. And I went down and sat on that and throwed my line in, didn't even bait it, I don't think, and it washed into the bank, and I sat there and fished.
2 years later, you lived up to that promise you had kept all those years. Mm-hmm. So that was your homecoming.
That was my homecoming.
I mean, you'd been home during your
Yeah, I'd been home quite a few times.
This was the final
That was the final time.
Step. Mm-hmm. That must have been quite emotional in some ways.
Yeah.
So you never had a parade other than the greetings in the New York Harbor?
Yeah, that I couldn't even see. See?
Your friends weren't very nice to you.
Yeah, I didn't get to see the striptease.
How maddening.
I thought so. I mean, any red-blooded American boy would have wanted right there to that porthole at least.
Exactly.
They said she took her bra off and threw it in the harbor.
Oh, my. That was a celebration. Well, do you feel the 50% was a fair decision despite the process?
I had no idea what it entailed. A stiff leg. You have difficulty tying your shoes, putting on your socks, and I've had a hip replacement total on both hips, and you don't double up the waist. So I use a long-handled shoehorn to get my shoes on, and then I can tie my shoes. And I lasso my toes to get my sock on, and then I work it on with my foot on the floor. Linoleum or tile won't do. You got to have carpet. You're handicapped too many ways. I worked in the building trades as a carpenter for years. Well, I'd sit down to mail baseboard. Fine, I could do that. Get in the corner. I'd nail left-handed. Had to one way or the other. Mm-hmm. You go up a ladder, you go up your left foot first, you come down your right foot first, you know, one rung at a time, and then bring the other down. It's the same way you go up and down stairs. And to begin with, I could do pretty good, but now I definitely want a rail to go up and down the stairs.
Understand.
And I turn sideways so that the one heel can be back behind the other, because if I go straight off, I can't bend my knee good enough and fast enough, my left one, to keep up with my body going down. No, I should have went out on 60 or 80%, but they didn't tell us those things. In fact, didn't give you any help at all, except what little medical personnel had warned us, and, you know, they probably did what they thought they could for us, but you couldn't vision how much it was going to handicap you. Right. But I got by and I earned a living.
Has a doctor that you've seen since then ever told you what they might have done better while they had you in Wales, in England or in Texas, or did they pretty much do what they could have done?
Well, I think that they pretty well done what they should have done in Europe. But they should have done more therapy on my knee here. And they did a little down at Bruns General when they could, when I was not in a cast, you know. But they done nothing up at Galesburg. It just vegetated there.
Right.
I had to do my own. And I worked at it.
Otherwise, you wouldn't have been able to get home.
My dream when I was young was I was going to be run the world's first 4-minute mile.
Because you had been a track person in high school, if I remember.
I ran the mile in high school. I think I might have made it.
My gosh, how exciting that would have been. As you think back, are there any other things that you'd like to talk about from this experience?
Like Walter Reed up there. That's nothing new, these guys from Iraq going up there, you know, it's so bad. There's always been army hospitals like that. That's half Congress's fault or more. They're not appropriating the money. They're not overseeing it. And maybe the Surgeon General has some fault too. But you get any bureaucracy, I don't care what it is, government, big corporation, whatever, you're going to have people that slack off, always. Mm-hmm. And you got that down there in the front line, you got that everywhere. And I think they should train as units and not individuals like we did in the latter part of World War II there. And General McNair, what was he, a 3-star, 4-star? He decided that that Sherman tank would get us clear through the war. They didn't need to make any changes. And you know what they called him in Europe?
Tell me.
The Ronson, guaranteed delight every time. We figured it took 3 Sherman tanks to knock out 1 German Panther.
If they were lucky.
If they were lucky. With that little old 75 millimeter on there that was a lightweight job. It wasn't even a high velocity. They finally put 76s on some of them. That was just this high velocity job. And on the TDs, they put a 90 millimeter finally, and that would do the job. The Germans used that 88 on the Tiger tank, and everybody always said they was attacked by a Tiger tank. There weren't that many of them during the Bulge, but they all looked big when you was down on the ground. A bazooka, that first bazooka was not guaranteed to knock them out. The larger size that they came up with later did real good hitting them on the sidewall, but not on the fronts. Depleted uranium that they use for the rounds anymore for armor piercing will go through about anything, I think. Might have went through one of the old battleships. It went right on through, you know. It was a little slim core.
I didn't realize that.
And it goes through.
In listening to your telling about some of the incidents, the one thing that strikes someone who has never been there is the fact that you accepted so readily, at least in telling, the danger you were in. In other words, you were telling stories about firefight as if that was sort of an exchange of pleasantries. And not pleasantries, but, you know, an exchange of insults.
Well, it was probably exchange of everything from 30 caliber on up to heavy weapons.
To the listener, it sounded more innocuous than that. In fact, it was horrendously dangerous.
I didn't realize that.
No.
But I realized that no matter.
My point is that as a veteran,
yeah,
this is probably the way you look back. This is something you just lived with and accepted. And that's
I've heard civilians say, a guy would tell him he had 2 Purple Hearts and he was in 1 battle. And they said, well, how is that possible? Well, the Battle of the Bulge lasted 5 weeks. It was entirely possible.
Sure.
And some of them lasted longer than that, I think.
I assume some of your colleagues who had minor wounds were sent back and then came back to the front lines after their...
We had guys that got hit in a minor circumstance, maybe even a broken arm, and never left the line. Really, they were treated and went back up.
Well...
Most guys don't want to leave the outfit, most of them.
Exactly. Because when you come back in a different outfit, you're back as a new person.
Yeah. Well, you're letting down the guys that are there.
Well,
I know that no matter how good I am with the English language and how well you understand it, there ain't no way I can tell you.
I understand. That we won't understand, yes. Well, I want to thank you for being willing to share your story with us today and for what you did during 1944, 1945 for us as well. Thanks again.
Thank you, both of you.